So this would be the last session on binomial theorem. In fact, not the whole class. Initial 15 to 20 minutes, we'll finish off a very small part of binomial theorem, which is left off. And that is basically finding out the binomial expansion when the power is, or when the index is, any real number. Okay, not necessarily a whole number. It could be a fraction. It could be a negative integer. So most of you have already done this concept in our bridge course, which we had in the beginning of this year. So I'll just quickly cover that concept and move on to a new chapter today. So the name of this topic is binomial expansion for any index. Okay, so if you have a term which is 1 plus x raised to the power of n, where n could be any real number, right? Need not be whole number. By the way, whatever I'm going to write, it is equally valid for whole number as well. But it need not be whole number. It could be, like, say, a fraction or a negative integer. Then this expansion goes like this. 1 plus nx plus n minus 1 by 2 factorial x squared. n minus 1 n minus 2 by 3 factorial x cube, and so on, dot dot dot. Now dot 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 doesn't mean it will go to infinity, right? It means it will go to the extent which n allows it to go. Okay, if n is a whole number, then this would be going to n plus 1 terms, right? We already know that, so let me write down over here. So it would be a finite, let me write it down over here. It would be a finite series if n belongs to whole number. So we all know that when n is a whole number, or when the power is a whole number, the total number of terms in a binomial expansion like this is supposed to be n plus 1. So that would be a finite binomial series, right? They will have limited number of terms. But if n is not a whole number, that means if it is an integer, which is negative, or it's a fraction, then the number of terms would be infinite. It would be an infinite series. Okay. Let me give you an example for this. Let us say I have 1 plus x to the power of, let's say, minus 2. Okay. So when I use this particular series for it, it will be 1 plus n is minus 2 x, then n minus 1 by 2 factorial x squared, then n minus 1 n minus 2 by 3 factorial x cube. Now here you would realize that these terms n minus 1 n minus 2 will never reach to an extent where it will start giving you zero. In fact, you can see this negativity is increasing. But from minus 2, minus 3, minus 4, minus 5, minus 6, it's always on the rise. That means it is not becoming zero ever. In case of whole number, there used to be one stage where you would realize that it will become a zero. For example, had it been just 2, then 2, 2 minus 2, 2, 2 minus 1, 2 minus 2, that would become a zero. That's why our series used to stop in those cases where our power used to be whole numbers. But in such cases, our series is never going to stop. Okay, it's going to be go on and on and on, right? So you may, you know, expand it properly and write it. But my aim is not to give you the expansions of this. My aim is to just tell you the structure of this expansion. Okay, so try to understand the difference here. The difference is, this is a universally applicable binomial expansion. If n is a whole number, it would be limited to n plus 1 terms. That means it will stop somewhere. That means it will be a finite series. But if n is not a whole number, means it is a negative integer, or let's say if it is a fraction, then this series will go on and on forever. Okay, so there will be infinitely many terms in that. One important thing that we need to keep in our mind is that whenever we are writing such a series where the number of terms is infinite, remember, mod of x here should be less than this number 1. Okay, only then our series will be convergent in nature. Okay, and then only such expansions make sense. I'll repeat once again. If your number of terms on the right-hand side is infinitely many and your series is not convergent, convergent means even if there are infinitely many terms, the sum should be finite. So if that condition is not fulfilled, then this expansion will not hold good. Are you getting my point? Okay. So what will happen? Right-hand side will become infinitely big in terms of magnitude. Left-hand side would be a finite term. This is something which I had already discussed with you during the bridge course when we were doing limits, standard algebraic limits, right? So this condition is very, very important for the convergence to hold true. Okay. Now many people ask me, sir, you have written for 1 plus x. What if there was a plus x? Doesn't matter. If you have a plus x, if you have a plus x to the power of, let's say, n, all you can do is you pull your a to the power n outside and write it like this. Okay. Now, why it is advisable to make it in this form is because when one of the terms is 1, it's very easy to write down the expansion, right? Because you don't have to care about the power that you are going to put on 1. That anyways is going to be a 1, right? So here we'll write it like this, 1 plus n x by a, okay? Then n minus 1 by 2 factorial x by a whole square, and so on and so forth. Okay. Again, it will be infinitely many terms. If your n happens to be a negative integer or a fraction, right? In fact, it could be irrational numbers also. And it would be a finite number terms if n is a whole number, right? And here, the condition that would be required for convergence is mod of x by a, that is this term, should be less than 1. You may also write it like this, mod x is less than mod a. Only under this situation, you will be able to make this series a convergent and hence a valid one. Okay. Now, this concept is not very, very commonly tested concept, but yes, it's good to know it. You never know, a question may be framed on it. Okay. So the idea is just use NCR expansion mode to write this term. That's it. There's no other concept involved. And yes, make sure you remember the condition for convergence. That's it. In terms of, see, combination is used in binomial expansion. You don't have to justify binomial expansion in combination. NCR doesn't make sense if N and R are not whole numbers. Okay. So binomial uses permutation combination idea, not vice versa. Don't get it wrong. It doesn't mean that these terms have to come from NCR only. No. Okay. NCR was used here when your N was whole number, right? Because those terms were already introduced before we started this chapter. But vice versa, don't think like that, that, okay, I have to have this as some NCR, this as NC, you know, NC1 and NC2, etc. No, NCR makes sense only when N and R are whole numbers. Okay? Else it will not make sense. Now, what kind of questions can I get on this? Let us try to get our hands on some questions. Not take much time. I think 2 or 3 questions is good enough for us. Let's check if I have some questions based on this binomial theorem. Okay, let's start with this question. If this term is approximately equal to a plus bx, okay, for small values of x, okay, small values of x because they want to meet that convergent situation, then what is the value of a and b? Let's try this out. Everybody, please work this out. I am putting the poll on. I think 2 minutes is good enough for time. Meanwhile, let me check the attendance. I think people have joined in. Let me take the attendance. Acha, one more thing before I forget. Has your school declared holiday for 14th, 15th, 16th, 17th? Is there any school or is there any people from school over here whose school has not declared holiday? Why? It's a season of Pongal and what do you call this? I forgot the name. Baisakhi and all we call it. Yeah. No. NPS people? I don't think so. Okay. SSRVM has their own schedule. Okay. I think Pongal falls, Pongal or this thing. Yeah, 14th. Yes, 14th. Never mind. Okay. Keep me updated. Keep me posted. Five, four, three, two, one, go. Please vote, please vote. Very good. One of the options have by far exceeded the others, and that is option number B. Let us check. All right, so let's take each one of these terms. Let's say the first term. Let's say the first term. 1 minus 3x to the power of half, right? Now, since you have to approximate it till the constant and the term containing x, we can write it as 1 minus half, or you can say 1 plus half into minus 3x. You can write it as 1 minus 3x by 2. I'm sure you would have used these kind of approximations in your gravitation chapter for finding the value of g for below the earth, right? If you go h, meters below the earth, what is the g due to gravity? Yeah. So let's write down the next one. 1 minus x to the power 5 by 3. This will become 1 minus 5x by 3. Okay. So on the numerator, you will end up getting 1 minus 3x by 2 plus 1 minus 5x by 3. Correct? In the denominator, before you start using anything, take 4 out. 4 will come out as a 2. And you will have 1 minus x by 4 to the power of half. Okay. So let's see how we can simplify this. This is nothing but 2 minus minus 3 by 2x and 5 by 3x. That's going to become a minus 19 by 6, isn't it? 3, yes, minus 19x by 3. Okay. This 2, I will write it as a half. And this, I will write it as 1 minus x by 4 to the power of minus half. Okay. So this will become half 2 minus 19x by 3. And this will become 1 plus half x by 4. Okay. So half, let us try to see. This will become x by 8. Let's write this as x by 8. Okay. So 2 into 2 will be 2. 2 into x by 4 will be, 2 into x by 8 will be x by 4. Minus 19x by 3. And other term you don't have to write because anyways, you don't require x square term. You only have to write out terms till x. Correct? Yeah. So this will be half 2. This will be nothing but 3 minus 76, which is minus 72 by 12. Minus 72 by 12. So minus 70, sorry. Yeah. Have I missed out anything? Oh, this is 19 by 6. Oh, sorry. Yeah, so this will become minus 70x by 24. Okay. On opening this term, you will end up getting 1 minus 35 by 24x. Okay. So A is 1 and B is minus 35 by 24. Which option matches with this? Which option matches with this? I think option number B is the right option. Well done. Well done, Janta. First question. Good. Is this clear how it works? One common mistake I have seen people doing, when you write your binomial expansions, we normally make this term as 1. Let me write it with yellow. Yeah, this term as 1. So this term should be brought out of that power. When you bring it out, please note it will come out under the effect of that power. So 4 will come out under the effect of power half. So that will come out as a 2. Right? So I've seen that mistake happening a lot with students. They just bring out the 4 term out, forgetting the fact that that 4 will come out under the influence of that power. Okay. Can we move on to the next question? Anybody who wants to copy this, please do so, so that we can proceed. Done. Okay. So let's take another one. The value of this expression is which of the following? Let's put the poll on. Let's put the poll on. 3 minutes. I think 3 minutes is good enough a time for this question. So it's an infinite series, which goes like 1 plus 1 third square, plus some weird terms are coming up. Indirectly, the question setter is asking us, whose binomial expansion is this term? Very good. I have got one response from somebody. Last 40 seconds. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, One. Go. Take a guess. Take a guess. Even if you're not getting the answer, no problem. Just try to see whether your guesswork is, you know, working or not, right? I always keep on saying, think as if you're answering a CET, this thing, CET pattern question paper. Remember, CET, there is no negative marks. So those who are planning to write KCET exams, there's no negative marks in CET exams. So you should mark all the questions and come, right? You never know. Of course, those which you have solved will definitely be correct. Those you haven't been able to solve, that also you should take a guess. Okay, now here, most of you have said option number A. Option number A. Let's check whether A was correct. See, if you look at this pattern, this is a question which is like to be solved by observation. You have to observe a lot, right? These terms are definitely factorials. 2 factorial, 3 factorial, and there is always the presence of 1/3, 1/3. So 1/3 is basically increasing. So something related to one of the terms being 1/3. Okay, now let's analyze this into more detail. This is nothing but 1/3 of 1/3. That's how 1/3 square probably would have come. Probably would have come. You know, I'm not taking a guess. And I have 1/4, 7. Now 1/4, 7 will only come when there is a 1/3, 4/3, 7/3 coming up, because you have to subtract a 1/1 each. Isn't it? So if I write this like this, 1/3, 4/3, 2 factorial, 1/3 square, right? And remember, if you're subtracting, it cannot become 4/3 unless until this is -1/3. Are you getting my point? See the analysis. So what I did was, I realized 1/4, 7, etc. is coming, right? Isn't it? So from 1 by something to reach 4 by something, right? This guy, and you have to subtract 1 from it, correct? So this guy has to be a 3 kind of a thing. Yes or no? Then only we'll get from -1 by something, -1 to -4 by something, correct? So that term has to be a 3. Are you getting my point? So here also I have to go and make a change. This is -1/3, this is -1/3. Right? And this is -1/3 square. Are you getting my logic over here? This is very important. Okay, so this term, that is your third term of the expression, you have to restructure it like this. Okay, so automatically your fourth term will also fall in place. So your fourth term would be -1/3, -4/3, -7/3, which is actually -4/3 is what? -1/3, -1. So if this is like n, this is n minus 1. This is n minus 2. Correct? And 1, 2, 3 is 3 factorial. Right? And since you have provided 3 from this base, you'll be only left with 1/3 whole cube. And 1/3 whole cube, please note, we have to write it as -1/3 whole cube, because your net power is positive over here. Your net power is positive, isn't it? So if you don't write -1/3 over here, your net power will become negative. Yes or no? Correct. So from this particular breakup, we can figure out that, oh, this particular expansion or this particular series was the expansion of 1 -1/3 to the power of -1/3. In other words, you were expanding 2/3 to the power of -1/3, which is nothing but 3/2 to the power of 1/3. Is this there in the options? Yes, option number A. Option number A is correct. Janta is absolutely right. Okay. Anybody who got this right by sheer guessing? Very good. Actually, doesn't make a difference. Half guessing for Aditra. Okay. Yeah. Does anybody want me to explain this again? Aditya, I just saw your message. Did you understand the logic now? Shreyas? Shreyas also? If you expand, okay. So Hariharan is a question. 1 + 1/2 to the power of 1/3, you're saying that? How can it this be? Because the second term would have been 1/3 into half. No, I have a 1/3 cube. Oh, sorry, I have 1/3 square. This term won't match. See, you are not comparing term by term. The cumulative expansion will be the same. Are you getting my point? If somebody says, from this series, figure out whose expansion was it, I would say this result. Of course, this result will also give you the same, but the cumulative expansion, not the individual terms. Don't compare the individual terms. If you add the whole thing, that result would be the same as when you expand this guy. Got it, Hariharan? Yes, I'll explain once again. Yes. Again, look at the pattern here. The pattern has 1, 4, 7, and you have factorial of number, and you have 1/3 repeated, you know, as powers of 1/3, right? So, as a person, if I have to look at, see, this term is what? This term is like nx, okay? This term is what? Nn minus 1 by 2 factorial x square, correct? This term is what? Nn minus 1, n minus 2, n minus, yeah. Correct? Now see here. From this term, looking at 1/3 presents, you can make a guess that it could have been 1/3 of 1/3, or it could have been minus 1/3 into minus 1/3, right? Yes or no? The presence of 1, 4, 7, see, when does a fraction having a numerator of 1, on subtraction of 1 will give you a fraction with a numerator of 4? Correct? See, this to this, when will, say, let's say n is a fraction. You're subtracting 1 from the fraction and you're getting a 4 on the top. Right? So 1, 4, 7 will come only when there was a minus 1 by 3 and you subtracted a 1 from here, you would get a minus 4 by 3. Again, if you subtract a 2 from here, you'll get minus 7 by 3. So the presence of 1, 4, 7 comes because you had n as minus 1/3. So this is ruled out and this is accepted. So this first term, the second term was minus 1/3 into minus 1/3. Third term, this is 2 factorial. This term is your 2 factorial. So this term, compare it with this term. And 1, 4, just provide it with a 3, 3 from this guy. So I'll just write it down. So 1, 4, 1, 2, 1 by 3 to the power 4. What did I do? I wrote it as 1/3, 4/3, 1/3 square by 2 factorial. And I placed minus sign over here because without a minus, we cannot get a minus 4 by 3 on subtraction of 1. Are you getting my point? This is the part which we need to understand. See, looking at this, this is the only possible answer. Right? This can have multiple expansions. This can have multiple expansions, but this answer would have only one result. They cannot do multiple results. Okay. All right. Let's look into one more question and then we'll close this concept. Yeah. Coefficient of x to the power 2 power m plus 1, x to the power 2, 2 is also raised to the power of m plus 1. In this expansion, is which of the following? Mod x is less than 1. Let's have around 2.5 minutes. 2.5 minutes. Time starts now. Very good. Last 1 minute. Last 1 minute. Seconds. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, Pranav, what is the option that you think is correct? Let's hear it out from Pranav. Okay, Pranav thinks B, while Janta here thinks A. Okay, let's see whether Janta is correct or Pranav is correct. All right, so first of all, I would like you to meet this very special term. This you will keep on seeing in very commonly in other chapters also. See, what is happening here? Constantly your powers of X are becoming raised to higher powers, right? So in such kind of questions, what do? Is we initiate a chain reaction by multiplying and dividing with 1 minus X. Okay. I'm sure most of you would have started applying binomial expansions on each one of these terms by taking it to the numerator. But before that, if you could do this, your life will become super easy. And this would become a hardly 20 second problem, right? If you do that, you would realize in the denominator, this guy will become 1 minus X square. This guy will become 1 minus X to the power 4. This guy will become 1 minus X to the power 8. This guy will become 1 minus X to the power 16, right? And till the last guy will multiply and give you 1 plus x to the power 2 to the power m plus 1. Okay. So this whole term will boil down. This whole term will boil down because of this chain reaction to 1 plus x by 1 plus x to the power 2 to the power m plus 1. Which we can write it as 1 minus x into 1 plus x to the power 2 to the power m plus 1 raised to the power of minus 1. Right? This is quite simple. We can apply our binomial expansion on this. Yes or no? So it'll become 1 minus x and 1 minus x to the power 2 to the power m plus 1. And other terms would be higher. Other terms would be of higher power. Okay. Sorry for the sign change. This is minus by mistake. Yeah. So this will become plus. Okay. Now the coefficient where the coefficient of x to the power 2 to the power m plus 1 is what I need. Read the question. Question, they want us to find out coefficient of x to the power 2 to the power m plus 1. So that will be nothing but this multiplied with this, because any other term would give you powers of x more than this. So the answer would be, the coefficient would be 1 in this case. That is when this guy multiplies to 1 over here. Okay. No other coefficient will appear other than this one. So Pranav is absolutely clear. Pranav is absolutely correct. Why did I say clear? Is it fine? Any questions? Okay. Janta was wrong. Pranav was correct. Okay. So with this, we complete the binomial expansion chapter. Now we are going to head towards a new chapter.